Now, with Jesus' death and burial, the disciples, they were crushed. When Jesus is killed and thrown in that tomb, they're crushed. And you can feel the despair in the disciples' statement in Luke chapter 24, 21. He says to the unrecognized Jesus on the road to Emmaus that they had hoped, that Jesus was the one to redeem Israel, the implication being that they crucified him so he could not have been. You see, we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel, but in light of the fact they crucified him, he obviously could not have been the one who was going to redeem Israel. So you see this tremendous letdown and despair among the disciples. And as I said near the end of the class last week, most ancient Jews, there was some diversity in view, but most ancient Jews believed that God would raise his people, raise them bodily from the dead on the last day, the day when he judged and remade the world. That was general ancient Jewish belief. What they did not expect was that this end time resurrection, this resurrection to immortal life. I'm not talking about resuscitation where somebody's brought back to life still subject to death. I'm talking about resurrection where someone comes back to life and, as Paul says, no longer subject to death. What they didn't expect was that this resurrection, you see, this rising to immortal life, that it would happen to someone in advance of God's remaking the world. They're all over, not all, but most of them are expecting, okay, we understand that at the end when God judges and remakes the world, there's going to be this general resurrection. What they didn't expect was that within history, in advance of that, that someone was going to be resurrected. That wasn't part of their theological landscape. And so when Jesus was killed, in their eyes, that was the end of it. You see, this had happened before. People had risen, Rome had killed them, and they stayed dead. And so this is what happens. So they have this despair. But as Luke says and records in Acts chapter 1, verse 3, Jesus presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs. Okay, there's no question he's demonstrated to them and shown them that he is in fact alive, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about, now what's he speaking about? The kingdom of God. Now isn't that interesting? When he comes, he says the kingdom is at hand. Now he's speaking to them after his resurrection about the kingdom of God. He really is focused on that. You see, he's focused on that. He speaks to them about the kingdom. And at the end of that 40-day period, he appears to them periodically over this 40-day period. He ascended back to heaven as they watched him on the Mount of Olives, and we talked about that last week. And through those multiple appearances and through the fact of the empty tomb, those things combined together, these appearances, these many proofs, and the empty tomb, and through those, the disciples came to know for certain, no question about it, they came to know for certain that Jesus had risen bodily from the tomb, and thus that the end time resurrection had begun with an individual in the midst of history. While this world carried on, that the not yet, the new age had invaded the present in the resurrection of Christ. See, while this world continued on, and they became a group of witnesses that nobody could shut up. You couldn't shut them up. And the title for the class this morning, or the subject of it, is the early church. Now, volume one of Luke's inspired writings, as you know, volume one is the Gospel of Luke. Volume two of his inspired writings is known as the Book of Acts. And Acts is, of course, it's the story of the church from Christ's ascension back to heaven where they watch him go until Paul's first Roman imprisonment. In fact, the end of Paul's first Roman imprisonment, which is in the mid-60s. So we're talking about roughly a 35-year span is what we're looking at in the book of Acts. Now, we're going to look specifically at Paul's life in the next two classes. So we've got two classes reserved for Paul's life. So we're going to look at that. And this morning, I want to focus on the church from the ascension up to the beginning of Paul's first missionary journey in Acts chapter 13. So the class today is essentially a flyover of the first 12 chapters of the book of Acts, excluding Acts 9, which is Paul's conversion, although it's reported in several places. But Acts 9, we'll be looking at that during one of the next classes. Now, during his time with the apostles in Jerusalem, remember he's there and then he takes them out to the Mount of Olives and then he ascends. Well, during his time with the apostles in Jerusalem, he told them to stay in the city until they received the promise of the Father, by which he meant their being baptized in or with, there's a preposition, go either way, in or with the Holy Spirit. And at his ascension, he told them that they would receive power. They would receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on them. And he tells them they would be his witnesses. He says, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea, in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. You'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And what Acts is in fact, it's a story of the unfolding of this mission of witnessing to Jesus. That's what we get, that's what we see. Which Acts chapter 8, verse 12, what is this witnessing to Jesus that begins in Jerusalem and goes to Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth? What does it entail? And you see in Acts chapter 8, verse 12, it says it involved the disciples preaching the good news about the kingdom of God. You see that preaching the kingdom of God, you see that also in Acts 19:8, Acts 20:25. It involved them in preaching the good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus. You see, it involved them in preaching the good news about the kingdom of God and in the name of Jesus. You see in Acts 8:12. But when they believed Philip, does he preach what? The good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. So when they're bearing witness to Jesus in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, we get to see, well, what's involved here? You see, you have this one message, but there seem to be two poles to this message. You see, two poles to this message. And you see the same two poles to the message in what Paul was preaching. You see, Paul in Acts 28:23, Paul is testifying what? To the kingdom of God and trying to convince them about Jesus. Kingdom of God, Jesus. You see those poles. You see it in Acts 28:31, again in Paul. He's proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ. So you have this testifying about Jesus, this message, this one message that involves this news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus. They are one message that have these two poles. Well, what's the message? The good news is what I've been telling you all along. It is the story. What is the good news that Jesus comes? It is that the long-awaited kingdom of God had in fact arrived. From this broken, wrecked world, this sin-sick world that happened way back at creation in the fall, that we've been limping through, and all of this destruction and evil and hatred and fragmentation, that God at long last has intervened to heal this world. This is the kingdom of God, and it has come. It has invaded this present age and this reality. It's arrived, albeit with the unexpected twist, at least they didn't expect it, that the kingdom's presence overlaps for a time with the ongoing old age or old order. You see, the new age has broken into the present, though now it's less than obvious. But it's a reality. The new age of the kingdom has come. But though it's now less than obvious, it will come to completion in the fully healed creation that is labeled in Scripture the new heavens and new earth. You see, now when you see this, you see when Jesus speaks in parables, when he speaks of the kingdom, he says the kingdom is like. And he always talks about, you see, this unobtrusive, gentle beginning, but what is in it? Powerful, that in that very seed is the fullness. You see, we always take those. He's talking about this. The kingdom is like this. It has this unobtrusive, gentle beginning, and yet packed in that beginning is all that there is in the end. And so this is what he's, this is this idea. When they come and preach the kingdom, they're saying the kingdom is here. This long-awaited kingdom has, in fact, and the other pole is that what? It's the name of Jesus, that the kingdom has been ushered in through the life and the ministry of Jesus. Ultimately, and especially through his atoning death, and that his being the one who introduces and ushers in the kingdom, who inaugurates the kingdom, it is signaled most definitively in his resurrection to immortal life, no longer subject to death, his ascension to heaven, and his outpouring of the Spirit. So they preach the good news of the kingdom and the great name of Jesus as the one who brought the kingdom. You see, this is it. This is what he is, the Messiah in that sense. What he's the ultimate anointed, the capital M Messiah, capital A anointed. He is the ultimate servant of God in what sense? He's the kingdom bringer. He's the kingdom bringer. He is the center of all healing of fragmentation and brokenness and sickness that has come because sin was introduced into God's very good creation. He is the center of that rescue effort. And so this is what they talk about. Now the Lord, through the casting of lots by the apostles, he chose Matthias to replace Judas as the 12th apostle. And there's obviously, you see the symbolism here, right? As there were 12 sons of Israel, they were the fountainhead of the nation of Israel. So the 12 apostles would be the fountainhead of the new Israel. Would be the fountainhead of the new Israel, the church, those who are called out in faith, both of physical, biological Israel. Because it's not all Israel that is true Israel, right? Those who reject faith in Christ show themselves not to be of Abraham. So it is a calling out in faith of those, both of Israel and of the world. Those who come. So it is this idea that we have the church is Jewish at its root, in that we have biological, physical Israelites who come to faith and thereby show themselves to be true Israel, in that they have the faith of Abraham, and then grafted onto those are Gentiles who also share this faith. And that creates, see, that is the new Israel. And so there's this symbolism here of the 12, you see, that they're called out and they're called into this new Spirit-filled community. Now, the Apostle Paul, of course, he's later called to be an apostle outside of this symbolism. He's called as one abnormally born. But that doesn't do away with the symbolism that is there in this 12. And you have to, I think it's important to see that. Now, the Spirit comes on the day of Pentecost with great markers of his presence. There's the sound like the tremendous wind. There's something like tongues of fire resting on the people. And they were all filled with the Spirit, and they miraculously began declaring the wonders of God in foreign languages they'd never known. They're declaring the wonders of God in languages they had never known. Now, Peter preaches to the crowd that Jesus' death was part of God's plan, that God had allowed him to be crucified by wicked men. Do you think you're getting over on God? Do you think that you're here playing chess with the ultimate grandmaster and you're over here, oh, I think I've got him? You never have him. You never have him. And so he says, see, this was part of God's plan. Is that he allowed wicked men to do this to Jesus, and that Jesus had been raised from the dead and taken up to heaven where he reigns at the Father's right hand. Jesus is the promised Messiah. He is the one, as I said, God's anointed one. He is the long-sought ultimate servant of God who ushers in this long-promised kingdom. And he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That is the reality. That is the fact. That is who Jesus is. Well, when the people hear this, it says they're cut to the heart. Meaning that they were convicted of the truth that he'd said about Jesus. They now are convinced, oh, that's who he is. He really is the Messiah, the anointed one, God's agent, God's one. And they are also convicted of their culpability in his death, whether by action or inaction, whether just in their acquiescence in what was done to him. But they're convicted of this, and they ask what they needed to do. And as I suspect all of you know, Peter tells them. He tells them they needed to repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of their sins. And he tells them they would receive the Holy Spirit, who having now been poured out was available for all. That's the significance of Pentecost, that the Spirit is now available for all who come to faith in Christ. Unlike you would have specific people that God would empower and give the Spirit to, all Christians, all those who come to faith in Christ, who are baptized in penitent faith, now receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so this is powerful stuff. And they trusted in Jesus as they did that, as they trusted in Jesus as the one Peter had described. As they did that, as they trusted in that, as they turned from their sin in loyalty to Jesus. There is no conversion without turning from your sin. Okay, this is one of the things that I don't have time. I've got so much stuff to get through, and if I chase any rabbit trails at all, I'm going to get caught again. But this notion in our world that you can simply think something and believe it and not surrender your life to it, and that that's going to make you a Christian, is nonsense. I can't say it any plainer than that. It's absolute theological nonsense. That when you come to that conviction, you then are in the valley of decision. If you're not have that conviction, there's no decision to be made because I don't believe it. It's only when I come to that conviction, the question then is, what will you do with that? Will you follow? Will you submit? Will you become a disciple? Or will you reject it and continue living as though you're the Lord? And so here they come to... They express this new devotion. They turn from their sin. They express this new devotion by being immersed in water on confession of their faith. And God forgave all their sins, and he added them to the community of the forgiven. He adds them to the church. And the church is those who are participants in the kingdom that Jesus inaugurated. We are the participants in that kingdom. We are the ones who said, yes, we understand and trust and know who he is, what he has done, and we are in with that. We are party to it. We are on his side. We are with him. We are the participants of this kingdom that God has ushered in and that is going to be consummated in that perfect state where there'll be no suffering, mourning, crying, death, pain. And we are those who are in that. You see, we are those who are in that, and we are being renewed, in fact, and being transformed in the direction of that completed kingdom. Here is this kingdom, you see, introduced, inaugurated, something less than obvious, rather inobtrusively. And what is it going to become? In it is this, and we are being transformed toward that goal, in that we're being transformed toward the image of Christ, right? And in that state, we will be like him. You see, we will be like him. And that is why, see, we ignore this stuff because we think it's irrelevant to how we live and all that stuff. But I'm telling you that eschatology and what this picture is, what God is doing, feeds into this life. It feeds into this life very powerfully. Okay, the members of this new community in Jerusalem, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Debate about this. This certainly sounds to me like an assembly. A formal kind of thing, but we can argue about that. Okay, they shared material things with each other. They ate in each other's homes. And the apostles are doing all kinds of signs and wonders. They're doing miracles. And the group had favor with the people, and the Lord continued to add to their numbers. So this community is growing. And Peter then, in the name of Jesus, he heals a man who's over 40 years old who had been crippled from birth. That's pretty powerful. I'm not talking about one of these TV things, you know, where I cure an earache. I'm talking about he's coming here and he's healing this guy. Everybody knew. This guy's over 40 and he'd been healed after being paralyzed and crippled from birth. The people are amazed. And Peter, again, what does he preach? He preaches, testifies to Jesus' resurrection. You see this all over Acts. The resurrection, the resurrection. He's come to life. And we just seem to downplay that in my judgment. But he's talking about it. He talks about the resurrection. He called the people to repent. And then he declared in Acts chapter 3, verse 21, that Jesus must remain in heaven where he is. They saw him go up to heaven, right? He must remain in that dimension, if that makes you more comfortable. You see, this reality is much stranger than you think. How can it be close and not? How can it be? Look, it's just, this reality is just much more complicated than you think. Okay, so he says he must remain in heaven until the time God chooses to restore all things. What do we mean, restore? Very good. Corrupted. Jesus will return, and when he returns, you will have the consummation of the kingdom. You will have the heavenization of creation that is so beautifully described in Revelation chapter 21, where this broken, sin-sick world is heavenized. You see, it is transformed. That's what Paul's talking about in Romans chapter 8. So this idea, he says that he must remain there. Jesus will return to consummate the kingdom, to judge mankind, and to give creation the ultimate makeover. And this is what Peter says there. Then in chapter 4, Peter and John are arrested by the Sadducees and their allies because they're proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They're arrested. They're proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. Now, as I told you last week, the Pharisees, like most ancient Jews, they believed there was going to be a resurrection of the dead when God judged and remade the world at the end time. The Sadducees didn't believe that. The Sadducees were like some of the pagans who were of the worm food school. You die, that's it, extinction. End of game. But the Pharisees and most Jews said, no, there's going to be a resurrection. Now, what is interesting, why did the Sadducees never, in this disagreement with the Pharisees, ever sic police power on the Pharisees? But they did it on the disciples. Why was that? Why was that? You see, the difference, as Craig Keener and probably others point out, was that the apostles, you see, they were preaching the resurrection in Jesus. In other words, they weren't saying, look, that the resurrection is a theoretical future hope when God judged and remade the world. They weren't resting on that. They were saying, rather, that it had already begun in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He is the first fruits of this end time resurrection that people have been looking forward to and believing. It's already happened in the person of Jesus. He is the first fruits of that one harvest. So you see, that changes the dynamic, right, of the argument. It's one thing for me to say, to argue against your claim that there is a theoretical hope that at the end when God judges and remakes the world, there's going to be a resurrection. It's another thing for me to argue that this guy is one. He's the first one. He is the one. The resurrection that we're all talking about has already occurred in history in the person of Jesus. Well, that then kind of creates difficulties, and the old arguments that they had were no longer effective about that. Well, Peter and John, they're warned not to speak in the name of Jesus. But they tell their accusers, look, we have to listen to God rather than you. What do you want us to do? You want me to listen to you? And so they tell them that, and then they say, look, we have to listen to God rather than you, and they're released, and Peter and John, then they gather with the disciples. They all pray for boldness. The place is shaken, and they continue to speak fearlessly. This is something the church in this day has to hear. I just sent something around. Meg had sent me this morning where some fellow here, they're threatening him in Idaho that if he won't marry a homosexual couple, he's going to go to jail. And people say, no, that's never going to happen. You got to wake up. You see, And you think Christians in this society won't go to jail? It's knocking on the door. But what did they do? They preached fearlessly. And we have to be ready to do that. You see, then, with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. You see this? They were doing this. They preach fearlessly with great power. They're giving this testimony. What are they testifying about? They're testifying to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. Why do I hear so little of that? Yeah, he came up. That's okay. Now let's talk about everything else. But why is that resurrection so central? Because that resurrection is exhibit A of the inbreaking of the kingdom bringing. So why are they saying that? Because of all that means. That means that he's the Messiah, the anointed one. He's the one who brought it. And that we're now living in this time of overlap where the kingdom has in fact invaded. You see, and this, I like this stuff and it's important. All right, so you see that. Now, years later, Acts 17, 18, we see Paul preaching Jesus and the resurrection. Acts 17, 18. And see, it's because of what it means in terms of the kingdom's invasion in the here and now. That's why this resurrection is spoken of so often. They continued sharing, the saints here in Jerusalem, they continued sharing with one another generously. And in Acts chapter 5, you know the story of Ananias and Sapphira, where they are killed by God for lying to the Spirit in claiming falsely that the amount that they donated was all that they had received from the sale of some land that they owned. And here you see God's special identification with the church, don't you? There is something about lying in that context where they come up and say, here and such, this involves so intimately with the community and what's going on with it. And we come to the apostles and we say, yes, this is all that we got. And that's just a flat out lie. And he says, what? You've lied to the Spirit. Lying's always wrong. But there's something about God's identification with the church that I think is leaking out in this. You see in other places. But I think there's something to it there, that it somehow it was a more direct form of lying to the Holy Spirit. The apostles continue performing miracles. More believers are added, it says in 5:14. Now it says they're added to what? The Lord. They're added to the Lord. Well, that's the community of the forgiven. Yes. But do you see this connection with the Lord? Later you'll see, he said, why do you persecute me? Well, who are you, Lord? I'm Jesus whom you're persecuting. No, I'm going to get these disciples. Right, you're persecuting me. You see this identification, and you see it there. People, they're performing these miracles so much so that the people are even, they're putting their sick people in the streets on mats and cots in the hope that Peter's shadow will fall on them. Are they doing some powerful stuff? They're doing powerful stuff. You say, how does the church explode out of Jerusalem out of nothing and then become, well, there was God's at work. See, he's working, and he's working powerfully. Well, the high priests and the Sadducees, they're filled with jealousy, and they arrested the apostles. An angel opens the prison doors at night and tells them, you guys go preach in the temple. And so that's what they did, beginning at daybreak, and the leaders, then they come in, they see they're gone. And by the way, this is one of these things where, you know, they apparently walk right by the guards and they don't see them. How do they do that? God didn't want them to see them. You see? So they walk out. They find out they're gone. Somebody says, hey, they're in the temple. They go get them. They bring them back and they remind them that they'd given them strict orders not to teach in Jesus' name. But they tell them again, we must obey God rather than men. That's it. I can't be silent. I can't be intimidated. I can't have threats and things tell me, you don't preach the truth of God. We are ambassadors and messengers, and we are called to say the truth to a dark and dying world. Even when the world rails against it, hates it, grits its teeth, we are lights that gently and lovingly say, this is the truth of God. This is the truth of God. Nothing will change it. You can beat me and all that stuff. Nothing will change it. It is the truth of God, and it is that voice. You say, why would they get upset? Why did they crucify Jesus, a perfect human being who was sinless? It is sometimes people do not like hearing that voice, but that's not our call. Our call is to preach it, and you see that this is what they're doing. Now, they wanted to kill the apostles. That gives you an idea how deep this stuff runs, right? They wanted to kill the apostles, But instead, there was a respected Pharisee on the council named Gamaliel, who is in fact Saul's teacher, Saul's rabbi. But Gamaliel talked him out of it. So they had the apostles beaten, and they told them not to preach. And then you see this in Acts 5, 41 to 42. Then they left the presence of the council, having just been beaten, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching that the Christ is Jesus. The Messiah is Jesus. He is the one. And I just looked at this and I said, rejoicing that they were counted worthy. And we're going to have to connect with this. You know, if I got any sensitivity and if I can read the straws in the wind, we're going to have to connect with this, brothers and sisters, and understand this. Acts chapter 6, there was a complaint in the community that the Greek-speaking Jewish widows who are part of the Christian community, the Greek-speaking Jewish widows, that they were being discriminated against in the daily distribution of food. So there was a complaint about that, and the apostles told the group that it wasn't right for them to be diverted from preaching the word of God. See, which was their optimal use in the kingdom. You know, people have different functions, roles, gifts. And they're saying it's not right for us to be diverted from preaching the word of God because we are specially suited for that, for us to be spending our time. You too good to wait on tables? No, that's not it. It's not that they're too good to wait on tables. It's that they're serving God and they're trying to spend their time in what they judge to be their optimal function. So they saw that it wasn't good for them to be taken that way, to wait on tables. So seven men of good reputation, full of the Spirit, were chosen to handle that task. And in my judgment, it's not coincidental that the next verse, verse 7, says, and the word of God continued to increase. You see, the apostles had been freed to function in their optimal role in the body, preaching the word of God, preaching the gospel, and that word grew in influence, and it was accepted as a result, so that a number of disciples, the number that you had there multiplied greatly, and many priests accepted it. And I see these things tied together, you see. We will function, we will major in what we should major in. And other things will be dealt with by what people should. And it's not like, well, who cares about that? No, he says, choose seven men who are known to be good, full of the Spirit. It's not like, hey, just this is a minor thing. Who cares? Just throw anybody on it. But it's that we have a certain role, an optimal use in the kingdom. And we see that. And we need to be about that. And that's what they were. Now, we have Stephen. He was one of the seven men who had been put in charge of this situation with the Greek-speaking Jewish widows. And it looks like where they're being discriminated against. And it looks like from their names that all of the men who had been put in charge of that project, that they were all themselves Greek-speaking Jewish Christians. Now, by Greek-speaking, Paul obviously spoke Greek. What you mean by that is that their native language, you see, where they come from in that native sense is Paul's raised in Aramaic. He's a native Aramaic speaker and probably Hebrew. I don't know. I'd have to look into that. And so you have that, and then you have, but he certainly is fluent in Greek, right? I mean, he's writing all these letters in Greek. But you have other people, see, who are their native Greek speakers. Well, they may also speak Aramaic. But this is their cultural identification, their first language, let's say. And so this is something, there's a distinction that is made here. And Stephen's one of those. And Stephen's preaching the gospel, obviously, to other Greek-speaking Jews. You have them there? They're Jews who are in Jerusalem and who have synagogues that are Greek-speaking. Well, Stephen's one of those guys. So where's he plying his trade? He's going to the Greek-speaking Jews, and he's telling them about Jesus. He says, all right, you know, this is my wheelhouse. These are my people. This is my first language. Let me at them. And he's preaching, and what happened to them? They couldn't answer him. See, filled with the Spirit and all this power that Stephen, so they're trying to trap him, and you know what they do. And what's he do? They couldn't answer him. So he's pressing the gospel to them, and they can't shut him up because they can't answer what he's saying. And so what do? They have him arrested on false charges. Well, that seems to be a common practice. You know, when you don't like somebody, you can't deal with what they're saying, you have them arrested. And that's what they had. They had Stephen arrested because they couldn't refute what he was saying. They're going to shut him up that way. And he's taken before the council, the Sanhedrin, and in chapter 7, he makes this lengthy speech about Israel's history. And in terms of the story, it's actually good for you to read chapter 7 because he kind of walks you through what has happened with Israel. So here he is on trial, and they're after him for claiming these things. And in Acts chapter 7, he gives them this long, lengthy speech, which ends with his saying that they always resist the Holy Spirit and kill God's messengers. Well, you can see this wasn't too endearing. You see, they weren't fans of that message. Whether it's true or not, you see. Of course, Stephen's telling them it's true. But they didn't like it. So he tells them that, and they wind up going crazy, and they stone him to death. Now, how that fits in, we'd see with the Romans. Maybe the Romans were willing to look the other way if a lynch mob did something and it didn't look like it was going to disturb the Roman peace. But generally, Rome had the power. They kept them on a short leash about the death penalty. That's why they took Jesus there. You see, but maybe they say, okay, you know, that's all right. We won't make a stink about certain of these things if you keep them away from me. But as soon as I hear a peep about this and it creates the slightest wave in my political world, you're going to be the one to blame. So I don't know, it's just not told. But here we have this group, they stone Stephen to death, and this spawned a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem. Now what's Saul doing? Saul, who of course is Paul, called later. But Saul is aggressively throwing men and women into prison. But since the apostles, you notice there's this great persecution, but the apostles, it says, they remained in Jerusalem. Everybody scattered except the apostles. And so it seems that the persecution, it focused on the Greek-speaking Jewish Christians. Because he says everybody scattered except the apostles. And so it looks like the persecution breaks out against the Greek-speaking Jewish Christians. And you recall that Jesus said to the disciples that they would be his witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And they started in Jerusalem, right? And then after this persecution, Luke notes that they were scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria. So you're going to be my witnesses. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, ends up there. Jerusalem, out they go. Out they go, the Greek-speaking people. And they go out into the surrounding area out there. And then we have Philip. Now, this is Philip, you see. They start in Jerusalem, then they go to the regions, the countryside of Judea and Samaria. And then we have Philip, who proclaims Christ in Samaria. And this is where Simon the magician was. He was among those who believed and was baptized. But contrary to expectations, and this is how I understand this. This is a more complicated thing, and I can't go into all this. But I'm just telling you how I understand this. Contrary to expectations, they didn't receive the Spirit when they were baptized. Well, we'd expect that from what Peter said in Acts 2. But contrary to that, you see, and you get a couple of clues, by the way, in how he phrases this, that it was contrary to expectations. But they didn't do that, so Peter and John were dispatched to Samaria, and the people received the Spirit when they laid hands on them. Now, I see this as an anomaly, but it is one that I think that God is doing something. There is a theological reason. I know people understand this differently. But there's I see it as a genuine anomaly when he says they hadn't received the Spirit. There was a reason why God was sending a message. God was making a point. And I think it had to do with the fact that the Samaritans had broken off before from Judaism and thought that they were the real people. And so this is a way of saying, no, no, no. In terms of the gospel, you're in fact derivative just like the Gentiles. You see, this is the Jewish root and you're added on with them. You see, I think that's a longer story than I can get into. You remember when Simon, he wants to buy the power that he sees associated with the apostles. He's sorely rebuked for that. Second half of chapter 8, I got to go. I heard that first bell. All right, Philip, he's sent down to rendezvous here with the Ethiopian eunuch who's reading Isaiah 53. And from that text, he preaches the good news to him. He then baptizes him. Philip's carried away to the city of Azotus. And then next we see him, he ventures to Caesarea. In chapter 9, we have the amazing story of Saul's conversion. On the road and in Damascus, his proclaiming Jesus in the synagogue, his rescue from Damascus, and his visit to Jerusalem, and we're going to look at that next class, Lord willing. And so that's in chapter 9. The last part of chapter 9, we have Peter, when he's in Lydda, he heals a paralyzed man. You see Lydda there. He's in Lydda. He heals a paralyzed man named Aeneas, somebody who'd been crippled, paralyzed for 8 years. He also raised from the dead Tabitha, also called Dorcas in Greek. Tabitha's Aramaic, Dorcas is Greek. They both mean gazelle. And so raised the dead person. This is pretty powerful stuff. And so he raises, that's in Joppa. He raises Tabitha from the dead. Chapter 10, the Roman centurion Cornelius, he sends these two servants down and a soldier to Joppa to invite Peter to come to his house in Caesarea. Cornelius invited him pursuant to the angel's instruction, with the expectation that Peter's going to deliver a message through which Cornelius and his household will be saved. And Peter obliges. There's more to the story, of course, but Peter winds up going there. He preaches this word. There's much to say here about this whole episode and this incident, but not time to say it. In one sentence, let me tell you what I think's going on. In one sentence, all right? This is God demonstrating in this episode at Cornelius' house that under the new covenant, there was no place for a Jewish nationalism that would withhold baptism from believing Gentiles until they submitted to circumcision. There is no reason. You cannot force them to become Jews. Now you'll see this breaks out later. This is something Paul faced. I think that's the gist of what's being said there. All right, first part of chapter 11. Peter then explains and defends his actions at Cornelius' house there in Jerusalem. In the second part, you see other Gentiles all the way up in Antioch are receiving the gospel now. So you see what's happening. What's happening is just going. People are eating this up. They're preaching this message. You see that in there. They're receiving the gospel. The church in Jerusalem, they sent Barnabas to Antioch. And he then goes over and he finds Saul in Tarsus. He brings him to Antioch. And then the Christians in Antioch, they decided to send financial support to the saints in Judea for a prophesied coming famine. And they send Barnabas and Paul to the elders down there. They send their gift that way. Now, chapter 12, we've got Herod Agrippa. I'm almost going to make it. Herod Agrippa, who's the grandson of Herod the Great, he's reigning over Judea, and he has James, the apostle James, the brother of John, has him killed. You see, he's being a Christian, right? He's being a Christian. Has him killed. He has Peter thrown in prison during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Peter's sprung from jail by an angel. He meets up with the saints in the house of Mary, the mother of John Mark. And he then left for another place to stay ahead of Herod. And after a time, Herod then returned to Caesarea, which was the administrative center. And in the last part of chapter 12, it reports that an angel struck down Herod. Because Herod was here not giving glory to God when people were saying that he's a god, not a man. Of course, they were flattering him. But because he didn't give glory to God and thought, yeah, you know, that's me. Well, the angel struck him down. And the description seems to be of some kind of bowel disease, so it need not mean that he died instantly. And then the chapter ends, chapter 12 ends with Barnabas and Saul returning to Antioch from Jerusalem, where they'd been sent down there with the gift for the prophesied coming famine. They then return to Antioch from Jerusalem and after having delivered the famine relief. And then in the next class, Lord willing, we'll look at Paul's life and his ministry. And I don't know if he just waited on me with the bell, but I'm through. Thank you.